Now let's examine the causes of microevolution. The first principal cause of microevolution involves chance events in very small populations. And this will have two ideas. First is the founder effect, and secondly is genetic drift. Now, here we have our original population. Remember, we're going to have the gene pool, all those capital A and all those little a alleles. Okay, they're going to be different colored marbles in a bottle. Okay, so you have a large number of marbles in here. Okay, but we're then going to pass it through a bottleneck. And we're only going to allow a few of those marbles out. Okay, by chance, we may get a non-representative sample. Okay, whereas in the original population, there might have been, well, maybe roughly twice as many blue as gray, or even pretty similar. By chance, if we only pull out three individuals, so they'd have six alleles, because they're diploid, right? We might, by chance, only get one gray allele and all the rest blue, and that's a big change in gene frequency from a founder effect. Now, genetic drift says, okay, we've got a really small population, but as long as this population stays small, chance events can cause a change in allele frequencies. So here we have a small population. It's got two alleles. So this is one, two, three, four, there's five individuals, a total of 10 alleles in there. And one of them is a heterozygote, okay? It's got the green allele and one blue, and everybody else is homozygous blue, okay? So it's very small. Now, by chance, what if that heterozygote didn't have any offspring, okay? So now the green allele is lost altogether. So you've got a change from 90% blue to 100% blue in one generation right there. Okay? Or it could go the other way. Maybe that heterozygote happens to be really lucky, has most of the offspring. So now in the next generation, still only five individuals. What if four individuals now carry that green allele? Again, a huge change, but this can happen in very small numbers. It's like flipping a coin. By chance, you might flip heads four or five times in a row. Whereas if you flipped it 5,000 times in a row, you would never get all same heads, okay? Now, to make this in biological terms, you get really quite extraordinary examples of bottlenecks when you occupy an island. So here's a blank island, and your own species doesn't exist, okay? And let's say you're a coconut, and by chance you're a lucky coconut that washes up on shore. You're the only coconut on this whole island, okay? But now you're the only coconut on the whole island, okay? Whatever genes you happen to possess, that's the entire gene pool for all subsequent generations. So you may have come from a population that was very different than you happen to be by yourself, but now everything descends from you. Now, we know that our own species has passed through various bottlenecks in our evolutionary history. As we'll see much later in the course, Homo sapiens originated in Africa. There are descendants of Homo sapiens who've never left Africa. They're still there. There's been diversification within the African continent. But then there were a few small groups that left Africa, went across to Asia, went to Europe. And then from Asia, there were small numbers that crossed from Russia into North America and colonized the New World. So each time they left Africa and then crossed over here, would have been a very small number of individuals to make that journey, and they may not have been representative of the population as a whole. So this is actually a rather slow cartoon here that shows how it was only certain times when people could cross from Russia. There was glaciation, and when the glaciers had melted, then people were able to pass into North America. But the rest of the time, North America was isolated from Asia. So what we see in the genetics of modern human populations is that, as we might imagine, this African, the original African stock, has never gone through a bottleneck. And so Africans have the most diverse gene pool. But as you leave Africa, going up to Europe and to Asia, there's a little bit less genetic diversity. So this is a measure of genetic diversity here. By the time you get out to Native Americans, they have the lowest genetic diversity of any human group. Now, we can see this on a very small scale in much more recent times. If we look at the genetics of a group like the Amish, originated in Switzerland in the 1500s, and about 200 Amish arrived in the US in the early 1700s. Now, those 200 individuals happen to possess a couple of alleles that are rare in the overall human population, but that's in the founder stock. And so their descendants, since they only mate with each other, have a higher incidence of certain genetic disorders coded by these alleles. So diabetes is one of them. Another one's called polydactyly. Polydactyly just means having more fingers than normal. And so this baby, this Amish baby here, has six fingers on each hand. So that's a founder effect. And you see those kinds of founder effects in all kinds of human groups that have become isolated geographically and reproductively from the rest of mankind.